Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Caty Weaver.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners. So we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English.
Today on the show, we hear stories from Mario and Jill Robbins. Bryan Lynn brings us the Science and Technology Report. And we close the show with the lesson of the day. But first, here's Jill.
Former U.S. President Donald Trump defeated Vice President Kamala Harris to earn a new 4-year term as the country's leader. Trump secured at least 277 of the 538 available electoral votes in Tuesday's election. In the U.S. system, the presidential vote is counted in the states. Trump's victories in Pennsylvania, Georgia, North Carolina, and Wisconsin gave him a majority of electoral college votes, which decide the U.S. presidency. Trump becomes the first U.S. leader to win 2 terms that are not consecutive since Grover Cleveland in 1892. Republican Party wins Tuesday, extended to Congress. The party won a majority in the Senate with at least 51 of 100 seats. Control of the House of Representatives, which is currently held by Republicans, was not yet clearly decided early Wednesday. World leaders offered congratulations to Trump after news media projections showed that he had secured a clear victory in the 2024 U.S. presidential election. Early Wednesday, many world leaders expressed their opinions on social media service X. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu praised Trump's historic return, saying it would strengthen the great alliance between Israel and America. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi offered Trump the heartiest congratulations. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky praised Trump's policy of peace through strength. NATO Chief Mark Rutte said he was looking forward to working with Trump to advance peace through strength through the military alliance. French President Emmanuel Macron offered congratulations, saying he is ready to work together as we did for 4 years with your conviction and mine. Trump is expected to be inaugurated for a new term on January 20th. I'm Jill Robbins.
Some health officials say Mpox cases in the Democratic Republic of the Congo appear to be stabilizing. The observation is a possible sign that the epidemic might be declining. Mpox is also known as monkeypox. The United States Centers for Disease Control and Prevention says the viral disease was first identified by scientists in 1958, when outbreaks of a pox-like disease appeared in monkeys. Until recently, most human cases involved people in Central and West Africa who had contact with infected animals. Last August, the World Health Organization declared Mpox in Africa a public health emergency of international concern. In recent weeks, the WHO says the Democratic Republic of the Congo, or DRC, has reported about 200 to 300 confirmed Mpox cases every week. That number is down from nearly 400 cases a week in July. A decrease has also been reported in Kamituga, where the new, more infectious variant of Mpox first appeared. But the UN Health Agency said last week that only about half of suspected infections in the DRC were being tested. And the agency noted that the virus is continuing to spread in some parts of the country and elsewhere, including Uganda. While doctors are hopeful about the drop in infections in some parts of the DRC, they still do not know what kinds of physical contact are driving the outbreak. Health experts are also concerned about the low number of vaccines the Central African nation has received. The WHO estimates that only 50,000 people have been vaccinated in the DRC, which has a population of about 110 million. Scientists also say there needs to be an urgent effort to vaccinate all of Africa to halt Mpox's spread and avoid worse variants. If we miss this opportunity, the likelihood of another significant outbreak increases substantially, said Dr. Zachary Risa, who heads operations in the DRC for the nonprofit group Alima. This year, there have been 43,000 suspected cases in Africa, and more than 1,000 people have died, mostly in the DRC. Risa added, "We've seen how past outbreaks, such as the one in Nigeria in 2017, can lead to larger global events if not effectively contained. The 2017 Mpox epidemic affected more than 100 countries." Risa said the decline in cases in Kamituga, where Mpox initially spread among sex workers and minors, is an opening to put more programs in place for vaccination, surveillance, and education. Georgette Hamouli is an 18-year-old sex worker. Hamouli said she did not know about Mpox until vaccination teams arrived in Goma recently. "The vaccine is also necessary," she said. "I think we're now protected." The Africa Centers for Disease Control and Prevention has estimated the DRC needs at least 3 million Mpox vaccines to stop the virus, and another 7 million for the rest of Africa. So far, the WHO and partners have provided 900,000 vaccines to 9 African countries affected by Mpox and expect 6 million vaccines to be available by the end of this year. Mpox epidemics in Burundi, Kenya, Rwanda, and Uganda are believed to have started in the DRC. Several Mpox cases affecting travelers have also been identified in Sweden, Thailand, Germany, India, and Britain. Dr. Salim Abdul Karim is an infectious diseases expert at South Africa's University of KwaZulu-Natal. He said Mpox outbreaks usually rise and then disappear quickly because of how the virus spreads. This time, however, he said, the virus continues to spread through sex and infected animals. We're in new territory with Mpox this time, he added. We're never going to solve this until we vaccinate most of our people. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
The American government has approved the use of Apple AirPods as hearing aids. The United States Food and Drug Administration, FDA, recently announced it had approved new hearing aid software created for some AirPods devices. An Apple software release this week launched the system on the devices. Apple said its AirPods Pro 2 are equipped with the software. The company added that the design will permit users to turn their AirPods into a medical-strength hearing aid device. The system aims to increase specific sounds in real time, including parts of speech and elements within a user's environment. Apple says another goal of its software release is to get more people to try hearing aids. An estimated 30 million Americans, about 1 in 8 Americans over the age of 12, have hearing loss in both ears. Millions could see improvements from hearing aids, but most have never tried them, the National Institute on Deafness and Other Communication Disorders says. Many others have tried assistive devices but choose not to use them. The reasons include high cost, poor quality, poor fit, how the devices look, or other reasons. But in recent years, there has been a push in the U.S. to get more people to try them. In 2022, federal rules changed to permit some kinds of hearing aids to be sold without a doctor's order or prescription. Such moves aimed to bring better and less costly models to patients. The highest quality hearing aids can cost from $1,000 to $2,500 or even more, but some over-the-counter models sell for between $400 and $500, said Elizabeth Stengel, a hearing expert at the University of Iowa. She spoke to the Associated Press. Stengel said some of the less costly models are only effective at raising sound levels, but they lack the personal settings and noise-blocking tools that can make hearing aids most helpful. AirPods cost $249 on Apple's website and sometimes less from other sellers. The launch of the software is part of a series of health tools Apple has released over the years. Most of them were built for the Apple Watch. These include several tools for checking heart and oxygen levels. Apple's software release also includes built-in tests to help users find out if they have hearing loss, and if so, how severe it is. Those who do have hearing loss can then set specific amplification levels. Experts say there are other similar headphone devices on the market that could also be used to increase sound levels for people with hearing loss. But many agree the AirPods edition is a good one, largely because of the way it could help normalize hearing aids for the public. Barbara Kelly is the director of the Hearing Loss Association of America. She told the AP that AirPods are considered mainstream and already widely used. This could get people to try the devices if they have been resistant to the look of traditional hearing aids. Kelly noted that many health conditions have been linked to hearing loss. These include depression, dementia, and greater risk of falls. The majority of people with hearing loss are over age 60, but it can affect younger people as well, including those who suffered a hearing damaging event. Everything we do, all of our relationships, whether it's personal or in our work life, involve hearing conversation, Kelly said. We're finding now that the sooner that people can pay attention to their hearing health, the better. The University of Iowa's Stengel noted the AirPods solution does come with possible issues some people may not like. Fit and comfort during long use might be one of these. And while other hearing aids are built to last through a whole day or more, she said the battery life of the AirPods does not permit for that. She also said that wearing AirPods might send a message to others that the person does not want to be disturbed or spoken to. But we're hoping that more people will try it and realize, yeah, these do help, Stengel said. I'm Brian Lynn.
We just heard the Learning English Science and Technology Report. Now, Brian Lynn joins me to talk more about the story. Thanks for being here, Brian.
Of course, Caty. Thank you for having me.
This week, your report was about the launch of software that can turn some Apple AirPods into a hearing aid device. Today, why don't we take a look at some terms in the report that might be new for our audience?
Okay, sure. That sounds good. For the first one, let's look at the term mainstream. Now, this is used in the report as an adjective to describe the current state of AirPods in society. An individual in the report says AirPods are already mainstream, meaning they are very widely used in the population. A basic definition for mainstream as an adjective would be to describe things reflecting the most popular ideas or values of a particular society or group.
And what other forms can this word take?
So, mainstream can also be used as a noun to describe these ideas or values we spoke about earlier. And it can also be used as a verb as well to express the act of placing someone or something in a mainstream setting or environment.
How about we look next at the word conversation, which describes a certain kind of speaking?
Yes, I think that's a good one, because English speakers likely will see this one often and might use it a lot as well. A simple definition for conversation would be a talk between two or more people, usually something informal, or in other words, not too serious. And again, the reason this word is so common is that all of us spend a great deal of time having conversations with others all the time. Now, we can also use this word as a verb to converse, which means to speak. And there is also an adjective, conversational, which relates to things in a conversation. Also, the term conversational has a very specific meaning, that is, to describe something written, but that reads more like a spoken conversation than a written piece.
Great to visit with you, Brian, and thanks for the conversation.
You're welcome. Thank you, Caty.
name is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our video series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In today's lesson, we're going to start with some questions. How long have you been studying English? How long have you been working at your job? And how long have you been living in your town or city?
Each of these questions shares something similar. Did you notice what it was? They all use the auxiliary verb have, the past participle been, and the ing form of the main verb. Have been studying, have been working, have been living.
That structure with the auxiliary have or has, the past participle been, and the ing form makes the present perfect continuous tense. We'll explain more about it during today's lesson. But first, let's listen to some of Lesson 50 of the Let's Learn English series.
In Lesson 50, Anna decides to go back to school and take some classes at a university. Listen to Anna as she talks to other students, and listen for the present perfect continuous tense.
Hey, are you finished with your report?
Almost. I've been writing and rewriting since last night. The subject is really interesting to me.
Me too. I've been studying this topic for a long time.
Am I late?
You're a little late, but don't worry, the professor isn't here yet.
How long has the class been waiting?
We've only been waiting for about 10 minutes.
So, how long have you been studying at Georgetown?
I've been studying here since 2015.
Awesome. You know, I've been wanting to go back to school for a long time. So, here I am.
Well, you picked a great school. I've been really happy here.
Studying, waiting, and wanting are all activities or states that last for a period of time. That is why we call these continuous actions.
In contrast, a very quick action, like dropping a pencil or turning on a light, is not a continuous action. It happens quickly and usually does not continue.
We express continuous actions with the present perfect continuous tense. And did you notice that there are two ways to answer the question, how long? Listen again to these two questions and answers.
How long has the class been waiting?
We've only been waiting for about 10 minutes.
So, how long have you been studying at Georgetown?
I've been studying here since 2015.
If we say the amount or length of time in our answer, we use the preposition for.
We've only been waiting for about 10 minutes.
And if we give an exact date or an exact time that the activity started, we use since.
I've been studying here since 2015.
Now listen to Andrew and me ask and answer a few questions. And try to notice how we use the words for and since when we answer the questions. Andrew, how long have you been working at Voice of America Learning English?
Not very long. I've been working at Voice of America since August of 2022. So, I've been working here for about a year and a half now. How about you, Jill? How long have you been working at VOA?
I've been working here since 2014, so I've been here for about 10 years now.
The present perfect continuous can be easy to learn if you repeat the form like this. I've been working. I've been living. I've been studying. I've been teaching. I've been learning. And so on.
And be sure to practice with other subjects or pronouns like this. You've been working. She's been working. He's been working. We've been working. They've been working.
This sounds like something we could make into a good chant or a song to help our listeners.
I think so. Maybe if we have more time, we'll make one. But now, let's go to the really fun part of Lesson 50. As usual, Anna makes some silly mistakes. She gives a presentation to the class, but it's on the wrong topic.
Anna misunderstood the topic because she confused two similar-sounding words. Listen for these two words. Also, when you listen, see if the voice of the professor sounds familiar.
Here comes the professor.
Hello, class. Sorry I'm late, but the snowstorm made getting here really difficult. I see you've been waiting very patiently. So let's get started. Who wants to give their talk first?
Oh, please, please pick me.
Anna?
Oh, me? Sure. Thanks. Here is my report on violence in the city. People have been looking for a solution to the problem of violence in the city. I say stop, stop! They are not the problem. In fact, violins are part of the solution. Violins create beautiful music that can fill a city with hope.
Anna,
if we put a violin in the hands of every child...
Anna, the topic is violence in the city. Violence, not violins.
Like I was saying, many people are saying that violence in the city is a big problem, a very big problem.
Violins and violence. Those words do sound similar. Listeners, have you ever been confused by two words in English that sound almost the same? Write to us and let us know. And Dr. Jill, I noticed that the professor's voice sounds, well, it sounds a lot like you.
That's because it is me.
Well, you do a good job acting like a professor. And maybe that's because you have been a professor in real life.
In fact, I was a professor at Georgetown University. We should also tell our listeners that Lesson 50 takes place at Georgetown University here in Washington, D.C. We'd like to again thank Georgetown and its students for helping us with Lesson 50 of Let's Learn English. Listen to Anna explain more about Georgetown at the beginning of Lesson 50.
Hello, and welcome to Georgetown University in Washington, D.C. I am going back to school.
Georgetown is the oldest Catholic and Jesuit university in the United States. The Jesuits are a religious order known worldwide for their many colleges and universities. Students have been studying here since 1792.
And Georgetown is just one of many universities in Washington, D.C. Well, Jill, we've been doing today's lesson for maybe around 10 minutes, so I think it's time to say goodbye.
But remember to email us about words that sound similar to you. Send your email to learningenglish@voanews.com. And you can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for listening. I'm Dr. Jill.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our show for today. But join us again tomorrow to keep learning English on the Voice of America. I'm Caty Weaver.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.